at the motel.
טוב, אני מוכן להתחיל לאמת, אבל אני לא יודע אם יש עוד אנשים פה. כולם פה מדברים עברית?
לא.
Not everybody, okay. I was wondering whether I have to speak in English or in Hebrew or some other language.
What other options do you have?
Yeah, not really. A few words in some languages.
I was hoping you wouldn't ask.
So is everybody here, or is there somebody outside that we... Okay.
I'll trickle in.
Trickle in, okay. Lighting is okay? Okay. So, good morning. My name is Yoram from Ben Shaul. I'm from the Faculty of Medicine, and I study a system that I'm going to tell you about today. And you heard already about the olfactory system from Danny, right, my colleague? And I'm going to tell you about this other system that I think he mentioned. Actually, I know he mentioned because I saw his PowerPoint. So let me begin. I hope I will be able to get through the whole set of slides that I prepared. It's usually not the case that I do. And of course, you're encouraged to ask questions. And if you ask too many questions, I will stop it so we can make better progress. So just a general word about chemical communication, because this is kind of the main proposed function of the system that I'm going to talk about. So chemical communication is very important, of course, in animals and many organisms, insects and vertebrates as well. And a term that's very frequently used, sometimes maybe even too frequently, is the term of pheromone. And what is a pheromone? You're probably all familiar with the term, right? But I'm not sure if you're familiar with a rigorous definition of what it's supposed to mean. It's supposed to mean a compound, or originally it was defined as a compound that is transmitted by one member of a species and is received by another member of a species and elicits a very stereotyped and a standard response. So this is the general definition, and it applies very well in insects. That's where really we can identify several pheromones, and in fact the first pheromone chemically was identified in these animals, which are what? No, I'm asking for some participation. Silk moths, yes. And the silk moths have, there's a pheromone that's emitted by the female, which you can see right here, which causes the male to fly towards her and then to find her and then to mate and produce new moths. And the identification of this pheromone was a very heroic feat at the time. It was a whole lot of, it's actually still hard for me to believe this number, but it's 10 tons of female moths were collected for this to eventually extract enough compound to be able to isolate it, and then this is the compound which is called bombycol, and it's actually the active ingredient that is sufficient to induce this flying behavior. One thing that I'd like you to note is that the males have very well developed antenna, which the females do not have. So it's an example of sexual dimorphism, which in this case allows the male to be very sensitive to the pheromones of the female. So this is a really good example of a pheromone. But not all chemical communication involves pheromones in this specific, or that adheres to this definition. Just to give a quick overview of what other kinds of semiochemicals there are. So semiochemicals is a general term, so semio is for signaling chemicals. So we can make a distinction between those that act within a species and those that act across different species. So within a species, one of them is are the pheromones, one class that we just described. And actually, they're again divided into two different types, two different classes of pheromones. One of them is called the releaser pheromones, and this is because they release a certain type of behavior. So So it's an immediate behavior. So this is one example of those, right? What is the behavior that's being released in this space?
Flying.
The fluttering of the wings and flying. And another class of pheromones, so it's actually another class of effects of pheromones, because the same compound can elicit both types of responses, is a primer pheromone. And what this means is that it actually induces some physiological process in another animal. So it's not an overt behavior that you will be able to observe immediately, but something is really happening. And this is one example of how pheromones affect pregnancy in mice, which I will not get too much in detail now because we don't have that much time. Now, another class of semiochemicals are called signature mixes. And these are usually complex, not necessarily, but usually complex mixtures, which help to identify different individuals. So one example, for example, is the lamb, which recognizes her ewe by its own specific blend of molecules that it emits. So this is a very different function than a pheromone. A pheromone has a very standard non-personal meaning, whereas the signature mixes have the opposite effect. They don't induce some specific kind of behavior necessarily, but they allow distinction between different members of the species. And then there are also semiochemicals, and I hope it's clear that a given semiochemical can have different functions in different contexts, okay? It's more of a property of the type of interaction that's mediated. So now we're talking about the cross species, and there's a definition, there's a distinction between allomones, which give benefit to the signaler. And this is just one example. I always tell myself I won't get into the details, but it's always hard not to give this nice example. This is an example of a spider. It's called a boa spider. It lives somewhere in South America. And what this spider does, it doesn't make a web, but it makes a net, a net that has a ball at the end of it. Sorry, it's a wire. The thread has a ball at the end of it, a sticky ball, and what this spider does, it emits a molecule that's very similar to the female pheromone of the moth. It's a subtype of the certain type of a moth, and this causes the male to be attracted not to its own female, but to the spider, and then unfortunately for that male to hit the ball, which is very sticky, and that allows the spider to flee. So this is an example of definitely a benefit to the signaler who is baiting the poor moth. And then there are also, the other definition is of chiromones, which provide a benefit to the receiver. So for example, a tick has the incentive to find its host, for example, a deer, and if there are any molecules that it can use to identify the deer or some other animal, then it would be defined as a chiromone. Okay. So Danny mentioned this, I think, in his slide, that chemosensation is not just mediated by one system. I mean, in humans, we're rather limited. We have the main olfactory system, but most other vertebrates, they have several subsystems. And you also should know that the receptors for odorants are what type of molecules are there? I'm hiding the board so you cannot see. What class of molecules are there other receptors? There are peptides, yes, but the receptors, those, what? Almost G protein coupled receptors. Okay, so right there, there are molecules that are these proteins that are 7 transmembrane molecules that are on the membrane, and they are coupled to G proteins, which elicit the downstream signaling cascade. So GPCR is the abbreviation, and this is just the relationships between different kinds of GPCRs which exist in the mammalian olfactory system. And you can see that there are some groups and there's a lot of diversity. And if we look at their projections targets, so if we're looking here at the external surface of the olfactory bulb, and there's a mapping here between these colors and these colors. And the point here is that there's different types of glomeruli, right? These denote glomeruli, which receive information from different types of receptor classes or subfamilies. And I'm not going to get into the different divisions, but there are divisions within the epithelium of the nose. And one important thing is that not all of these glomeruli, for example, those that I will talk about today, do not receive their information from the main olfactory epithelium, but rather from other regions still within the nasal cavity, but not the nasal epithelium itself. Okay, so there is a division here. Some of the divisions are also within the Mayo factor system. So the Mayo factor system itself has several classes of receptors, which you can see here by their different designations, or class 1, class 2, TARS, and so on. And there is a mapping, a rough mapping, but there is a mapping towards the surface of the bone. And this is another depiction of the system. Now you can see a rodent's head, and you can see the various cilia. So here, MOE, what is the MOE? What does it stand for? Yes, it's the Mayo factor epithelium. These are where the cells of the Mayo factor system reside. And you can see here the olfactory bulb, and you can see here the structure that's called VNO, which I will talk about today, the vomeronasal organ, which is the sensory organ of the system that I will talk about today. So actually the two largest systems in most vertebrates, and almost all vertebrates have these two systems. We are exceptions to the rule, and some higher apes are as well, but most vertebrates have both a Mayo factor system and a vomeronasal system. There's also a Grunebur ganglion here. It's a small structure, which also contains sensory neurons, and a septal organ, these are very small structures, but they also contain sensory neurons, and I will not talk about them at all right now. I just want to mention that they also exist. So we're talking about the vomeronasal system today, also known as the accessory olfactory system. Have you ever heard of it, by the way? Some of you have. Some of you have, some of you haven't. Okay, so this is this shows diagram, a very coarse diagram of the Mayo factor system, where you can see the nasal epithelium and the Mayo factor bulb, and you can see the vomeronasal system. So it has the vomeronasal organ, or VNO as I just mentioned, right here in yellow. I will talk about this organ in some more detail. And there is a part, specialized region within the olfactory bulb, which is called the AOB, or accessory olfactory bulb. So you can see it's actually a short. Actually, this shows the whole olfactory bulb, and a sub-region of it is the AOB, which receives information from the VNO, from the vomeronasal organ. So in some ways, the two systems are similar. The sensory neurons in the nose, in the nasal cavity, they send the projections to the olfactory bulb. So what are the main differences, and why are actually two systems needed? And the truth is that we don't have a definite answer to this question. There are several ideas and hypotheses, and we know how they differ functionally, but what are the evolutionary driving forces that that induce the need to have two different systems is not fully clear to us. So what are the differences? First of all, the different sensory organs, as I already mentioned, and this corresponds to different physical nature of the stimuli. So for a molecule to reach the Mayo factory system, it has to be what? What physical property does it have to have?
Volatile.
It has to be volatile and reach the nose, right, the nasal cavity. But this is not necessarily the case in the vomeronasal system, because the key thing here is for the molecules to be soluble. So this sniffing via the VNO occurs by contact, sniffing or stimulus uptake. So it's actually, as I will show you, it's a pump that actually sucks fluids, and if the fluid contains any stimuli, they could be detected by the system. There's another difference, that also the time course of the two systems is very different. So the Mayo factor system is coupled to the act of breathing. So this is the time course of the system, which operates at several hertz, even 10 hertz, or up to about 10 hertz when an animal is sniffing rapidly. And it's much, much, much slower in the vomeronasal system. I don't like to promote myself too much, but I'll just tell you. Today there came out a study from our lab that Michal Franco, she is also an LSAT student several generations above you, and we did an analysis of the careful analysis of the time courses of the two different systems, and just to show how slow the system really is. And so this is one difference. Another difference is the different receptors. So I showed you this tree of the different receptors. So they're clearly distinct. Those that are the GPCRs for the Mayo factor system and the vomeronasal system. And this is significant because it implies that they have different ligands that they're sensitive to. Another difference is the circuitry in the olfactory bulb. And we'll get into this a little bit, but the wiring of the system of the microcells in the glomeruli is different. And this probably has implications for what kind of computations are performed by each system, and it's an interesting difference as well. Another important difference is the projection targets. So what are the main projection targets of the MISO cells of the male factor system? Prefrontal cortex and other cortical regions, right? To some extent also the amygdala, but the vomeronasal system is very much heavily projecting to amygdalar regions and not to cortical regions directly. And it is, this is one of the reasons that people think, we think that the vomeronasal system is very much associated with innate behaviors that are mediated, that are controlled by regions like the amygdala, as opposed to the cortex, which is a system that's well known for its ability to form new associations and new forms of learning. So what are the fundamental, as I mentioned, we don't fully know what the real, what is the cause, what is the reason for the, what is the essential difference. But one good hypothesis is that it's developed because the stimuli that activate them have a different physical nature, volatile versus soluble. And the other idea, which is kind of an elegant idea, but doesn't stand so much the test of the experiment, is that one system is devoted for innate processing. That system would be which one? The vomeronasal system, and the male factor system is for forming new plastic associations. We know it's not that simple because definitely there are some innate processes that are mediated by the male factor systems. And also, here I am again doing this. We also, in our lab, we're showing that you can also use the accessory factor system to form, new associations. So it may be a general framework to understand the systems, but it's not a very strict dichotomy yet. It appeared before, well, it developed from fish initially. So the development from fish, which had an organ that that was mainly water soluble or operates in water, is similar to the vomeronasal organ. And then the divergence, I think, happened early on. So I don't think you can say that one system is more is earlier than another system. Okay, in that sense, I'm not sure about the. When exactly the different receptors develop, that would be another way to know it. I'm not sure about it. It's definitely a system that, in later stages, also seen some degeneration, as I said, in higher primates. And in, but there's no clear distinction that you make about which one develops earlier. Yeah.
So there are no molecules that can affect both.
Oh, definitely there are. Many molecules can affect both systems. Okay, if it's a very the receptors do have a lot of overlaps between them in what they can identify. And of course, the fact that a molecule is volatile does not mean that it's not soluble. And some of the soluble molecules are also volatile. But when we're talking about very heavy molecules, proteins, for example, they are to a much larger extent detected by the DNO rather than the MOE. Okay. So let me tell you a bit about I think Vidani also did this, talking about the different stages of the system, and this will be also the structure in today's talk. In the first stage in the system is the vomeronasal organ, the VNO, and this is where the sensory neurons are located. So what you see here is the head of some typical rodent, and you can see here this section, and here you see this tubular structure. This is the VNO. So this is the one VNO, there are two VNOs, one on each side of the nasal septum, and here you see a coronal section, so it's a section just like this. So this is the floor of the nasal cavity, this is the nasal septum, and these are the two sides, left and right. And to understand how this organ works, you have to know the following structures. So first of all, there is a lumen right here, the yellow crescent thing. So this is the lumen, so it's a space that's it's a dead end on one side, and it opens into the nasal cavity at its other end. Okay, so it's a tube, it's a dead end tube. And within this lumen, there are the sensory neurons. These are the sensory neurons of the vomeronasal system. Now, another thing that's important is the blood vessel right here, these two red circles. There are blood vessels that run in the VNO. And another important thing to understand is this whole thing is enclosed in a bony, rigid capsule. And what this means is that when the blood vessel dilates, what happens to the lumen?
if the blood vessel becomes bigger, what happens to the lumen which is here?
It shrinks, right? It's pushed.
And when the blood vessel is constricted, as it is here, the lumen is expanded because there is a this creates a negative pressure inside the VNO. And when the lumen opens up, because it's closed on one end and it's open to the nasal cavity on the other end, if there is some fluid there, it will get sucked in. And if this fluid contains some molecules that can be detected by the receptors, it will elicit a response in those neurons. So the idea, the way that the system works is by dilation and constriction of this blood vessel, which induces a pumping action. And the truth is, we don't know a whole lot about when pumping is or how it is controlled. We do know that it's controlled by sympathetic innervation, so it's likely, or we also have other evidence that it's associated with epochs of arousal. At least in hamsters, where the study was done, it was seen that when an animal is placed in a new environment or when another animal is introduced to the cage, there is some activity in the VNO. But it's a very hard physiological parameter to measure, actually. It's a very hidden structure, which makes it difficult to study the system. So as far as we know, we cannot look outside at an animal and say whether the VNO is active or not, unlike the manufactory system, where we know that when an animal is breathing, there is delivery of stimuli to the manufactory procedure. But there is, I said that you could usually not detect it from the outside, at least not in mice, but in many other animals, it actually is visible, or we think that this corresponds to uptake by the glomerulonasal organ. So this is called the Flamin response, which is most famous in horses, but other animals do it too. So zebras and deer do it, and sheep do it, and even cats do it, by the way. So you hear, see a cat sniffing, and it makes this funny face, which is probably corresponding to uptake to the VNO. And actually, I felt that even I sometimes I feel like doing something funny, not that I don't think I have VNO, but to do something that I think is maybe some solutionary trait of this thing that activates. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about. But I once or twice felt it in my life. So anyway, this is also corresponding to stimulus uptake by the VNO. Okay, so let's say a few words about the receptors in this family, not a whole lot. I don't want to talk too much about this. So there are actually three families of receptors, which one is a relatively minor one. So there are two major families of receptors, which are called the V1Rs and the V2Rs. They have the same, roughly together, there are about 300 different receptors. Let's say 190 V1Rs and about 120 V2Rs. So just they're different in the structure. The V2Rs, for example, have a very big extracellular loop, which probably has a role in detection of the molecules. And one thing to note is that, so this is now we're looking at the VNO, okay? This is a cross-section of the VNO. And you can see here, this would be the blood vessel that was shown in red before. This would be the lumen that was shown in yellow. And this is the epithelium, which I don't remember which color it was, but you can see that now it's divided into two different colors. And the two different colors correspond to regions when there are neurons that express the V1R versus the V2R class of receptors. So there's some type, or there's a pretty clear segregation at the level of VNO, at least a topographical segregation of the two types of receptor family expression. And this is also maintained at the level of the AOB. So sensory neurons that have V1R receptors project to a more interior part of the AOB, and those that are the V2Rs project to a more posterior part of the AOB. This is not maintained at later regions, probably, but it is an important distinction, and we do believe that there are differences in types of molecules that each of them detects. I want to show you a little bit of the physiology of these neurons. So what you have here is a multi-electrode array which records extracellular activity from sensory neurons. So this is a preparation that you just place the epithelium over the electrode array. Is this familiar to you? Something that's okay. And this was just actually the first systematic analysis of these neurons. And what it showed here is that they do respond to urine. This is the most obvious stimulus to test in the context of of chemical signaling between animals. And what you can see here, without going into the details, is that different neurons are tuned. For example, in this case, they were shown to be tuned to the sex of another individual. So you have neurons that respond more strongly to male urine, and you have neurons that respond more strongly to female urine. So this is a very basic discrimination, and these neurons have the ability to do it, and there's a tuning curve that you can construct from it, and there's nothing very surprising, but at least makes sense of the system playing a role in such behaviors. Yeah.
Different neurons, you mean between the classes or a pattern?
It's just different individual neurons. So in this analysis, for example, it's not known which class they belong to. We do know that both classes of neurons will respond to male and female urine, but probably to different compounds within them. So, yeah. So this is just different individual neurons. One question which still occupies researchers is to identify the pheromones, although, as I said, I don't like the term pheromone because it doesn't hold so well in this context, but nevertheless, it is interesting to identify the components that activate the system. And one very interesting class of compounds are the major urinary proteins, and these are proteins, so they're very appropriate candidates to be ligands of the BNO rather than the male factory epithelium. And these are proteins that, well, humans generally do not secrete proteins in our urine, but many other animals do, such as dogs and mice, and they probably have a very important signaling role. And here you see biochemical analysis of the content of these major urinary proteins. And the nice thing about them is that supposedly different individuals, at least when we're talking about wild populations, each different individual has a certain combination of MAP alleles or forms that distinguish it from another individual. So it kind of reminds us of a barcode, right, that each individual has some kind of a pattern of expression. And because these are encoded genetically, it's not some biochemical byproduct, so it's something that's supposed to be stable across the life of an individual, these patterns can be used for discriminating different individuals. And there's a lot of evidence that this is indeed the case, that behavioral evidence as well. So these are very interesting class of proteins, and it has been shown in this study and in other studies as well that the sensory neurons in the VNO can respond to these MAPs in a selective way, so they can be distinguished between different types of MAPs. And actually, connecting to your question, these are, just as a side note, these are detected by the V2R family of receptors, not the V1R family of receptors. And here is another family of molecules, which is also interesting, which are actually detected by the V1R type of receptors, which are the sulfated steroids. So steroids are very common. They have many signaling and physiological roles in the body, and there are different classes of steroids. And they're also secreted in urine, but before they're secreted, they have to be made soluble, and this is by sulfating them, so it's a chemical modification. And the interesting thing is that it was shown several years ago that these are a very strong stimulus for sensory neurons of the vomeronasal system. And again, you can imagine how the physiological status of an animal can be reflected to some extent, at least, by the metabolites that are secreted in urine, and this allows other animals to get information about other individuals. And here you see an example of an array of different neurons that respond to different subsets of these sulfated steroids. So that's another type of ligand, and there are more. A recent study showed that fecal feces also are a very strong stimulus for the system, and there are some bile acids there that are being detected by sensory neurons. And we know that many secretions from our experiments, we know that saliva and vaginal secretions, for example, are also very strong stimuli for the system. So almost everything that we tried and has been tried that has to do with bodily secretions between different mice was shown to activate the system. But only in a few cases we know what the active stimuli, what the active molecules are, as is the case with MAPs and with these sulfated steroids. Okay, signal transduction. Do you remember signal transduction in the male factor? know that Danny had a slide about it. So, again, we won't get into the details here so much. The basic idea is similar, that you have the G protein coupled receptors, which I just mentioned before, that they bound to ligands and they change their conformations and they activate the G proteins themselves. You have a different G proteins, it doesn't matter. I mean, you don't need to remember this. But also the downstream signaling cascade is different. So this is it's not the cyclic AMP that's the second messenger, but these are the DAG, the diethylglycerol, and the inositol phosphate, which play a role through phospholipase C. Again, details which are not crucial now. What is important is that the activation of the neurons occurs via opening of a very important channel, or very specific channel for these neurons, which is called the TRPC2. So maybe you heard about the TRP family of channels. So this, the TRPC2 is one form, and it's a cation channel, which can conduct sodium and calcium, and it's activated probably via the diethylglycerol that's being generated by this reaction. But the reason that I'm mentioning this is that because this provides a handle, this specific channel provides a handle to make a genetic lesion in the vomeronasal system and to measure the effect of this lesion. Okay, so it's an elegant way to, it's not a perfect way, we now know, but it's a pretty good way to selectively destroy the function of these neurons and see what it does to behavior. And this is sorry? Yeah, so this is the idea. This was the understanding, at least when these studies were done, and then it was shown that there are some exceptions. So there is some TRPC expression in the male plastic system, and there are some neurons in the VNO that do not express TRPC2. They're probably a very small minority. Some people think that it's actually an artifact of development. But so broadly speaking, it clearly destroys most of the function of the system, and it's probably very selective, maybe not 100%. So this is a study that was one of the first, there are two studies that were done at the same time, actually lesioning during this genetic knockout and observing the effects of these of this knockout. And this you can see in this figure here. So this is not a raster display, these are not spikes, but these are actually it's a depiction of behavior of mice. And the behavior here is a resident intruder assay. Are you familiar with this? So you have one mouse, you introduce another mouse, and you measure how frequently the resident mouse attacks the intruder mouse. And so here, let's look first at this side. This is the intact VNO, so these would be normal mice. And when a castrated male is introduced into the cage, not much happens. Each row here corresponds to one trial, to one test. So there are not a lot of ticks, but when you introduce a castrated male that has male urine smeared on it, you can see that the resident is much more aggressive towards it. And now look at the males without a functional VNO, so the males with a knockout TRPC2, you can see how peaceful everything here is, right? Nothing is happening. And so this is one study, and there's another study that came out at the same time, both in very prominent labs, which also showed this thing, but it also showed, and both showed the same things. And that, the other aspect is looking at mating behaviors. So here you can see mounting and intromission of males. So this is male-female mounting, so how frequently a male will mount a female introduced to the cage, and the comparison between the TRPC and the control shows very similar behavior. So the TRPC males can reproduce, which is a very good thing for these analysis, otherwise it would be very hard to work with these animals. So in terms of behavior towards females, at least in this very, very artificial context, they seem normal, but look what happens when you have introduced another male to the cage. So you saw here before that there was no aggression, but not only was there no aggression, but there was actually an attempt by the male to mate with the other intruding male. So something is different about these animals, probably in how they, it's not that they cannot discriminate between males and females without the VNO, they definitely can, but somehow the meaning of these stimuli is different. And they lose the aggression, and they also probably gain, maybe it's a default behavior that is revealed when this organ is
first result is not surprising.
Sorry?
The first result is not surprising.
It is surprising. I'm not sure if you're asking or saying.
No, I'm asking because I would expect that.
Which result? Which result? Which first result? Sorry, this one?
Yes.
It is a bit surprising. Yes, it is a bit surprising. But it is, yeah, we would think that I would think that they would mate less, would seem
yes.
But we also have to remember that these are very artificial scenarios. They have just one male and one female in the cage, and you know, they don't have a whole lot of other options of things to do there. But maybe the incentive to do it is different. Maybe the selectivity would be different. So it's a very rough measurement that is somewhat surprising, yes. But it shows that they have at least the basic ability to be attracted and to make. Sorry? Yeah.
Is the only channel that's activated by the chicken pox receptor? If I knock out the DNA?
This is the idea, yeah. And they're also, so I'm saying it's not a perfect manipulation. It was also repeated by surgical ablation of the VNO, and it shows also similar results. There are other channels involved, but they're secondary to the TRPC2, so basically, yes. Okay, let's think about it this way. And this was one study done in males, so the focus here was in males, but similar similar or related studies were done in females and in other contexts, and generally what what we learned from this is that the VNO is very important, not just in such male-female behaviors, but also in parental behaviors, also in predator avoidance. That was another study that came out for the males and the females. So this definitely supports the role of the vomeronasal system in social interactions generally. Okay. So that was the first stage, the VNO. Now we're going to the second stage, which is the accessory olfactory bulb, which, as I showed you before, it's smaller part of the bulb located here at the very back end of it. So this is everybody shows pictures made by Monica Hall, right? And so do I, because they're really very pretty. And this is a picture. So what you can see here is, what are these guys? I'm not asking what are these guys. What are these guys? Which cells are these? Come on, you should know from Daniel Lecter. What? Almost M, microcells. Microcells, okay? These are the microcells, which provide the sole output. So this image is rotated relative to this one. So it's like the mouse is pointing down. Okay, the AOB is up here in this image. Okay, these are the microcells. They are very important because they get all the information from the sensory neurons via the what? Glomeruli, which you can see right here. And they send the information to the rest of the brain, to the olfactory cortex, for example, via their axon. And this is now the accessory olfactory bulb. You can see it's a little bit less organized, right? You can see the microcells here, they're smaller. They're not in one specific layer. They're actually usually not called microcells, but microtusked cells, because they're distinct. I don't know if Danny talked about micro versus tusked cells. Never mind. They're smaller, the whole structure is less organized, but the general feature of them sending dendrites to glomeruli is still valid also here, and they also send their axons, as we said, to different regions, but they send them outwards. So this was just general organization. Now here's one very interesting difference between the two systems. So you may, I hope you remember, that the wiring diagram at the level of the MOB is relatively simple. So you have one microcell extends its dendrite actually to one glomerulus. So it samples from a homogeneous population of receptors, right? This is the idea in the main olfactory system. In the sensory olfactory system, at the first stage, we have different types of sensory neurons actually send their axons to many different glomeruli. So you remember or you know that in the main olfactory system, there are only two glomeruli usually from each type. Did you talk about this? Doesn't matter. But here there's a more distributed pattern of projections, but nevertheless each glomerulus does contain receptors from a given class of receptors. The interesting difference is that the mitral cells in the AOV, you don't see it so well here, but you can see very well here in this older study. You can see it, this is the cell body, and these are the dendrites, and these are the different glomeruli. And this is just a very heterogeneous set of mitral cells, but you can see that some of them may send glomerulus to just one, the dendrite one glomerulus, but others can sample from a large number of glomeruli. And some have been observed to send their dendrites to 12 different glomeruli. So this is a lot of different inputs that a cell can receive. And of course, this suggests that these cells can already do what? What type of computation can they? Looking for the word integration, for example, right? They can already combine information from different types of receptors, and maybe already at the level of the accessory olfactory bulb, already at the level of the mitral cells, maybe have a more complicated representation of the stimuli that entered the glomerulonasal organ. So we don't really know how these cells, what exactly are the computations that they make. It's very hard to test this question, but at least there's a very good reason to believe that there's more integration across different channels going on in this system, in the main, in the accessory olfactory system, as compared to the main olfactory system.
But here you said it's one glomeruli.
Yes, a glomerulus, we can still think of this as a homogeneous structure. But a given mitral cell can sample from multiple different glomeruli.
Only the AOV?
Yeah, in the clear?
No, okay.
So one glomerulus is still homogeneous in the sense that it receives receptors from a different class.
Different?
Same.
A difference from the same class. Yes, these words are very important. From the same class, whereas a given mitral cell sends dendrites to multiple glomeruli, each of them same receptor, but different receptors and different glomeruli. Yeah.
The same mitral cell is sensitive from different, but only present in the AOV and not in the AOV.
Yes.
Right.
Correct.
So yeah. We also call them mitral
cells. We call them mitral tufted cells, but yes. But and some people just call them mitral cells because they're very similar. They're analogous. Okay. So cortex don't have mitral cells, they have pyramidal cells.
Yeah, but they mean the role itself, the integration or getting information from different
neurons. I'm not sure I understand your question. What?
The convergence, I was talking about the convergence.
In the cortex? So we don't know. So we don't know very little about how the actions of these neurons are projecting downstream? Is this what you're asking me?
Mm-hmm.
No. So
maybe about the structure?
No, go ahead. Don't
combination between the MOD in the belt to the cortex in the metaphorically system.
Yeah.
Is that similar to the combination?
We don't know.
Between the glomeruli to the
between the AOB. Okay, between the AOB and the downstream projection in the amygdala? Okay. We don't know the answer. So we know a little bit, we know quite a lot actually. In the main olfactory system, I think that Dami showed you some evidence for convergence and that you need several inputs to activate a pyramidal cell. We don't know. It's not that the cortex, it's the amygdala that plays a bigger role, but our understanding of the wiring of the system is much less advanced than the main olfactory system.
There are also glomeruli in the AOV that are two populations of glomeruli. The AOV and the MOV, or do they sample from the same one?
They're different. They're very different. So I mean, yeah, they're spatially separated, and they also have morphological differences between them, and of course, different receptors. Okay, did I answer the question? Okay. It's kind of like the class is over now, right? Okay. I hate doing this. I'm not going to do this to talk to you. Can I take 5 more minutes from your time and talk to you a little bit about the AOB? No? Sorry, a little bit. I won't run over the thing. I'll just tell you about the first study that came out of the AOB. This is a study that I went and led me to do my postdoc in this lab. And the first study in the AOB in intact mice was done in behaving animals. Can you guess why in behaving animals? I mean, usually it's very difficult to do a study in behaving animals. It's much more difficult, the whole surgery, the whole operation. It's hard to find cells. But here it was not possible to do it in anesthetized animals so easily. And the reason is that we don't have a way to activate, or there was no way to activate the VNO, or to know that it's being activated, right? Because it's being activated sporadically by the sympathetic nervous system. So you cannot just insert an electrode as you can to the main olfactory bulb and know that the animal is breathing, and you can just deliver stimuli. So this was more complicated. And this is why the first study was utilized behaving mice. And what you can see here is, you can see here, this is an anesthetized mouse. It's just the object mouse, not the subject mouse. So it's lightly, what is it, lightly? It's not moving. And then there's another mouse which is has electrodes in the brain, and the activity is monitored. And what's really nice about this, it's not, you know, it's maybe not too surprising given all I told you so far, but it shows that there are cells that are very responsive to a mouse sniffing another individual. And it was also shown that these cells can be selective. So, for example, some cells would be activated when a certain strain of mouse is introduced here as an anesthetized stimulus, and other cells would be more selective to another animal. They could be sex selective, and so on. And for me, this was a very nice study because it showed, I really like it when you have a region in the brain that has a response and you can really associate it with behavior, you know, not like these responses in the hippocampus and other brain regions, which we don't really know always what they stand for. So this was a study that the first one, and then there are studies by our group and by other groups that look more carefully at what are the different stimuli that activate the system, because now we have ways to systematically activate the VNO or to deliver stimuli into it, and we know we can analyze the system, we can analyze responses to the system. One thing that we see is the system definitely responds to male-female stimuli in a selective way. Now I'm going really fast just to give you the main idea. We can also see that these cells respond to predator stimuli, which is not surprising. But what is surprising is that some individual cells respond both to predators and to mouse stimuli. And so they don't give a very clear message to neurons that read their information, right? Because predators and female stimuli, for example, call for very different responses. And so I'm going to skip over this part and just tell you that looking at the later stage in the amygdala, so this is analogous to the cortex in the male olfactory system, we already see that there's a more selective response of neurons. So they're more selective to one category versus another. So there's a sharpening of the responses. You're not expected to be able to see this from what I tell you. And another interesting thing that emerges at the level of the amygdala, which does not take place in the accessory olfactory bulb, I think I'm covering all of these things very quickly now, but another thing at the amygdala is that there's a very pronounced sexual dimorphism. So the amygdala of a male mouse is much, cells there are much more responsive to female stimuli, and the opposite is true to female mice. So female mice are much more selective for male stimuli. It's a very strong effect that suggests that promotes the idea that this is really a region and a system that's devoted to some type of a sex-specific behavior, maybe has a role in productive function. Yeah, maybe next time I will learn. Usually I have 2 hours and it's not enough. Now it was 1 hour, I had a lot and it was not enough. But I hope you got the idea. We did talk about the VNO, a little bit about the AOB, and very little about the amygdala. So, thank you. I think Danny should be here soon, right? Because you have 10, you're presenting papers, right?
Yeah.
Who's presenting papers?
שזה יתקשר למשהו שהוא יותר אבולוציוני כדי
לא, ברור, זאת שאלה מצוינת, אבל אין לנו נתונים פה כל כך רועשים, גם מבחינת ההתנהגות של בעלי החיים, אנחנו לא יכולים להגיד לך. אני לא יודע להגיד על הדברים שהם אומרים, או אחרי ראשון נפלות. זאת שאלה מעניינת, כאילו. אני חושב שגם על קופים כאילו מדובר על ה... שם מדובר, ואני לא עוקב אחרת, ואני לא יודע, אבל אני חושב שמה שאני זוכר וגם מה שאני משער, שזה יכול להיות לא נכון, זה שאין הוכחות, שאין מודל טוב של הומוסקסואליה. אבל זה לא, אמרתי כי אני מוציא את המילה שלי בתור... יש, כן, יש כל מיני שונות להסביר את ה... לא זוכר מה היה, אפילו את הגן. זה לא יכול, בטוח שזה לא הגן. זה כן יכול להיות הגן שמשפיע על איזשהו מסלול מטבולי ורמות הורמונים שהוא בעצמו משפיע על בית הלכים שלהם. זה כן יכול להיות משהו כזה, ברור שאין גן. ברור, אבל זה נעשה. דברים פלסטיים שמשתנים, מטויים מצב, כל זה וכל זה. אז אין הייפ מודל טוב.
אולי
בסופו של דבר, זה יכול להיות מה?
זה יכול
להיות מספרים מעניינים, כאילו קשר. כן, נכון, נכון. אבל אני יודע, הייתי שם את הכסף ליד לספרים פסיכולוגיים בשלב הזה, כאילו, אז זה... הספקתי חצי, שני שליש מכון. ואז ב...
את השני האחרונים לא קוראים?
אני בסוף ככה עובר, פתאום אני מגלה שאני יכול להגיד את הכל בשתיים, שלושה משפטים, אז...
לקחתי מהרנת האופניים.
אה, נו, ו? נהנית? או דור אחר?
אני מאוד נהנה.
אה, דור אחר קודם.
לא, אבל היה.
טוב. בוא נניח, חכה את שלי, בוא נעלה כזה כיף, כאילו זה כזה הבדל, זה לא...
כן?
כן, זה ממש, אני לא חשבתי שזה יהיה כזה.
בגלל
העולמים שונים,
או...
הרבה יותר מהר,
הרבה יותר מהר. גם וגם.
כן.
אז הקסט האחורי שלו,
זה
גם
שני אנטי
גדול
או
משהו
כזה. שזה גדול, אתה מתכוון.
לא.
הוא לא כזה גדול.
כן, הוא חצי משלך.
אבל השאלה היא מה הקדמי שלו.
בגדול הוא אמר לי שבעליות קשה.
אלף תכף, כן. טוב, אני לא יודע אם כבר תלכתי. זה מתחיל בעצם, נכון? אבל אני אפנה לכם פה את הכל.
כן, ברור שאפשר להחליט, אני לא יודע כמה
דברים האלה עולים. זה עולה, זה כמה מאות שקלים, אני חושב, תלוי ברמה.
אני
רוצה
לעלות ואני
אראה
למה
התכוון. איפה חיבור של זה? רגע, זה שלי, אני לא משאיר את זה פה, אבל יש פה את זה.
והנה
חיבור שלו.
תודה.
אני
חושב שאני אנסה
לעלות.
אבל הוא לא השתמש
להם
לטיפוסי כוח?
אני
חושב
שכן.
הם היו במקור שתיים? הוא החליף את זה לאחד? או זה היה אחד?
כן, היה שניים קדמים.
אה.
ואין לו את זה? הוא כנראה השאיר את ה...
כנראה השאיר את הגדול איתו?
לא, מאחור הוא השאיר... אני חשבתי שכשאתה מחליף את הקדמי לשניים, אתה מחליף גם את הקסטה האחורית כדי לשמור על התחום.
הגיוני מאוד, כן.
נכון? ואתה מאבד רומות
אמצע, ואתה שומע
את התחום.
לא עשה את זה. אתה לא שומע את כל התחום. זה לא...
או,
הוא
שומע
אחרת,
מקדיף את התחום.
כן. לא יודע, אני חושב את זה.
הם
ירים
כאילו
בפרק, חנייה
רגע. מצב
טוב? כן. כן, אז זה באמת, זה לא אותו דבר. אני גם אם שלי הרחבתי ב...
וזה לא
מקום, זהו. כן, אתה ממש תביא אותם לחיבה. אתה רוצה, תביא אותם... טוב, זה... אפשר לעשות איזו חיבה באזון פה, תביא איזו שם. מחר אפילו, לא, מחר זה יהיה לי בעתיד.
מחר, איך אני
אמור
להגיד?
מה?
we're Makan and Shiran, and we present a paper and privacy code for other identity that was published in 2017 in Nature Communications. But before we present the paper, we'll start with a question. So, what can you see here? The Eiffel Tower.
Oh, where's Makan?
And in this picture?
Also the Eiffel Tower.
Okay, so although...
You're very smart.
So although you saw the Eiffel Tower in different angles and lighting, you could recognize it, right? So indeed, we can recognize the visual object independently of its lighting and its view angle. Another example is that we can recognize an auditory stimulus, for example, a word, no matter who's saying this word or the voice of the speaker. More generally, we can identify stimuli independently of its changing properties. So this article focuses on the olfactory system and the fact that we can identify another independently of its concentration. So the research question is how exactly are we able to recognize the other independently of its concentration? Before addressing this question, we'll talk a little bit about remind you a little bit about the primary olfactory sensory pathway. So you can see here the molecules of a certain odor, and they bind to the olfactory sensory neurons that we'll call from now OSN. Each OSN relates to one family of olfactory receptors that express the same gene, the same common gene. And we can see here that each molecule binds to OSN from one family, from one type of family. Here it's represented by a different color. For example, the red molecules will attach to the red OSN. And the axonal terminals of the OSN converge to structures in the olfactory bulb called the glomeruli, as you probably know. Those structures, every glomerulus, the structures within the synapse between the olfactory nerve and the dendrites of the mitral cell. Each mitral cell actually gets its input from one family of OSN, and their axons are sent to the olfactory cortex. Questions about this? We'll talk about, this is the response to a certain odor of two OSN in different concentrations. So we can see that here, in different concentrations, the activity of the OSN is different. For example, in concentration 10, only OSN 1 responds, but in concentration 30, both of them respond. So the question that arises from this is, if the activity of the OSN is different in different concentrations, how exactly can we, as I said before, identify the other independently of the concentration? So this article will try to overcome this problem and answer this question by the model that will be presented. Okay, so we can see here that the novel odor concentration increases through time, and through time, the glomeruli are activated one by one according to their sensitivity to the specific smell. So for example, here ID and Q were activated, but I were activated first. This means that he is more sensitive to this specific smell. And we can see in different concentrations that as the concentration increases, more glomeruli are activated. So here there are more glomeruli that are activated in than in low concentration. And in higher concentration, there are more glial that are activated than in this concentration. And we also can see that the pattern of activation, the order of the glomeruli that activated through time is quite the same between different concentrations. As you can see here, I, B, and Q were activated first, and also here in the medium concentration and here in high concentration. And that leads to the hypothesis that those primary glomeruli, in this specific example is either D and Q, they are they determine the other identity. I just have to say that it's not like really three glomeruli, there can be more and more complex than that, but that's the simple simple model.
They activate a different pattern with different concentrations?
Yes.
What do you mean?
The theory shows that to activate I, D, and Q with a different concentration, it's always activated.
Mm. Ah, so it's the same one that that always identifies, that always like determines the identity of the smell. So it doesn't matter what happens afterwards. It matters, but not to the identity of the to the identification of the smell. So no, those are the same one every time. Okay. So as I said, the hypothesis is the first that the first activated glomeruli will determine the other identity. We can see if the hypothesis is correct, then those primary glomeruli won't be activated, there won't be an identification of the other. So if we, for example, mask the other, and it will lead to one of them to not be activated, then there will be no identification of the smell. So for example, here, we masked and the glomerulus Q wasn't activated, so there's no identification. But when there was mask after the activation of all the primary glomeruli, there was an identification of the smell.
Is there results or is there?
No, it's the model. It's the model that they're presenting. And now they will use this model to detect the behavioral outcomes and more. So it's really connected to your question. So because of this model, they used a masking paradigm that was what happened is that they used optogenetics to excite all of the OSN, and then that led to, because all the OSN were activated, we couldn't isolate which other, we couldn't identify the other, because that was one other. I'll explain more. Okay, so if we have certain OSN like in other one, OSN that led to those are the glomeruli. So if not all the OSNs were activated in a normal, when just without the mask, another was released, and then when not all the OSNs are activated, just some of the glomeruli are activated, and then we can identify the smell. But if all the OSNs are activated by the mask, all of the glomeruli are activated, so we can't really know, we can't really identify the smell because.
So they're activated at the same time because you said that the first that are activated are the ones that.
Right. No. So yes,
they're activated at the same time by the excitation of the autogenic.
What Shiran means?
No,
okay.
What he studies about how we identify the same smell with different concentrations.
Yes.
But the meaning of what she said is, okay, at the beginning you smell, okay, you begin to smell, and you begin to activate the most sensitive glomeruli. Okay? For example, as you said, I begin to smell and I is activated, then D, then Q, then A, B, T, okay? At some time, I begin to mask. Okay? What does it mean? I activate all the glomeruli at the same time, okay? Once I activate the glomeruli, I don't have any pattern anymore. Like, I know that at the beginning, ID was activated, and then at the same time, I activated everything. So now I didn't have the first pattern of IDQ, and then I'm not able to recognize the other, okay? So that activation is of the mask is end of the identification of the other. Like normal cues.
We'll
get to it.
Yes, but as to answer more about to other question, if the mask was, as I said before, the mask was after the activation of the primary glomeruli, then we can identify the other because the mask was afterwards, and then the activation of all the other came later after we. After we identify. Okay, so I'm just reminding you that the mask was on the OSN here, and they project to the mitral cells. That they are here. So we'll see the effect of the mask on the at the mitral cell level. So we can see here the main firing rate as a function of the time post-stimulus. And we see that at the first 50 milliseconds, there's an excitatory response that's followed by an inhibitory response. We can also see that after 100 milliseconds, the activation returns to its baseline activity. So we can say that the mask is active for at least 100 milliseconds. After we saw the response at the mitral cells level, the researchers wanted to further examine the masking influence, so they used a computational model. So they wanted to check that the mask influence uses the influence of the mask. By this model that discriminates between two others. For that, they use a SVM, support vector machine, to classify the data. What happened is that at first we have a practice stage where all the system gets activation patterns of the glomeruli for different for other A and other B, like what's the activation that you can see here in dots, what's the activation patterns for other A and other B, and then it tries to create a separating line it seeks a separating line that will be separating between those two orders. And after that...
Can you just explain what the
axes
are? What were
these dots? Ah! Okay, so these dots, every dot is an activation pattern of the glomeruli that we can, it's like a vector of all the glomeruli that they turned on in one trial. And then afterwards, the model does is try to to find a separation between those two, to classify between those two. And afterwards, we give an additional pattern that was induced by one of the others, and then the model tries to predict if it resembles to the pattern of order A or order B, and if its prediction is correct, we see it as a success. Is that clear? No, it's just the values. Okay, we simplified it.
Here, just look like one example, which is in 2D. In our case, which is each dot should represent the pattern activity of glomeruli, it should be like n dimension when n is the number of glomeruli that you have in the neuron.
Yes, we simplified it to two-dimensional, but in reality, it was like as the number of glomeruli. And it's like n dimension.
This is a 2D example.
Yes.
Now we just put in just like think about it like just an example, okay? I give you like the height of someone and his weight, okay? And I tell you that was a man, okay? Or the blue was woman. And I give you someone new and tell me it's a man or it's a woman. Now same thing, but each dot is not just two things like a pattern of glomeruli, like glomeruli I, D, Q, A, G, it's order A, okay? All order A and all the pattern of glomeruli. All order B, all the pattern of glomeruli. Now I'll give you a new pattern and I tell you decide it's order A or order B.
And everyone you get
properties of the order and
you get just a vector of all the glomeruli that were like turned on.
The dimensions are basically glomeruli.
Yes.
So this is the world. This is a cartoon of a mouse that has just two glomeruli. Just take the two activity levels of the glomeruli and start each other.
It's not from the article, it's just to illustrate the SVM.
The activity level of glomeruli A and
the glomeruli B. It's not really good. Okay, it's clear?
So they did it for all pairs of glomeruli?
No, they used not pairs of glomeruli, they used all the glomeruli, and then it wasn't like two-dimensional model, it was and a dimensional model as the number of the glomeruli. Yeah, and the next slide will be much clearer. So in every trial, we get an activation pattern of the glomeruli, and then the SVM tries to classify to one of the others, and then as I said, if it succeeded, then if he predicted right, then it succeeded. So we can see the performance as a function of the time post simulation. So we can see that was by the SVM. So we can see that in the animal trial there was an increase in performance as the time post simulation was longer. And but in the mouse trial in blue, until 100 milliseconds, the performance was a chance level. So just after that, it started increasing. So that's why we may assume that the mouse is efficient for at least 100 milliseconds in eliminating the other information. And it resembles to what we saw earlier, the effect of on the module itself. And now, Antan will explain you about the behavioral paradigm.
Okay. So now, until now, they use like SVM, a machine, an algorithm, to separate between order A and B. Okay? So, for instance, in SVM, we'll use that mouse. This is a principle. So, what is the paradigm of the experiment? The mouse has to discriminate between two orders, A and B, across different concentrations. Okay? So basically I give a mouse an order with a given concentration and the mouse has to identify it. How does the mouse identify it? It needs to lick either left or right according to the order. Okay? It's pretty simple. But now Here you can see like the inhalation of the odor through the pressure transducer. But now the more complicated part is the marking part. Okay. So as we said, it was done using optogenetic. Okay. So there is a laser here in the olfactory bulb of the mouse. Okay, in the glomeruli. And when the laser was activated, it was the beginning of the mask. What is a little bit complicated to understand that every trial, okay, on masked trials, the mask was active for a different time. The beginning of the mask, okay, was modulated. Okay, so here it begins after he inhalates all that, and here after he inhalates all that. Okay. So is the paradigm clear? So now, what we see is the performance of the mice, okay, as a function of the mask onset latency, which is the time where I begin the mask. Okay, basically, what does it mean? If the mask was begun at 50 milliseconds, the mouse has 50 milliseconds until the mask identifies the odor. Okay. But okay. So what do we see here at the graph? We have two graphs: high concentration and low concentration. We see that when the mask onset latency was really short, like the mouse has really low, small time to identify the odor, his performance was slightly above the chance level. Okay? And then the performance recovered slowly until around 100 milliseconds it reached the level of unmasked trials. Okay? Of course, they are better at high concentration rather than low concentration because it's just easier. So the second step is the step that we do in most of the sensory tasks, okay, in experiments. We want to begin what is the reaction time of the mouse. Okay? So they just plot the reaction time as the performance as a function of the reaction time. And what did they see? They see that this graph, which was the graph we see before, which is the performance of the mass onset latency, is qualitatively the same of this graph. The only difference is the shift here of 66 milliseconds. Okay. For example, if you like this line here is in gray, here at 100 milliseconds, you will see the same line here at 166 milliseconds. Okay. So why is this shift, and why there is a shift, is because of the constant motor delay. Okay. What does it mean? The mouse takes decision. Now it has to leak, and this takes 66 milliseconds. Okay. The point of this graph is to tell us that the peripheral encoding of information limits the timing of olfactory decision making. Or in our world, I begin the mask, I stop the ability of the mouse to better identify the deterrent, and then she will act and take the decision and leave. Is that right or left? Okay, clear? The decision of the odor is just here. Okay, here you have this graph, okay, for a given concentration. Now, if I lower the concentration, the time that it will take for I.
You can show
the like here. Okay, the time here for I to be activated, okay, will be a bigger time than here. Big, okay?
Yes.
Just the switch of the time, but the same pattern.
And did you understand the shift with the 66 method?
Okay, so if it's clear, we can go on. The next step, the researcher said, okay, so maybe the beginning by this idea of primacy coding, of coding the identity of the odor by the first glomeruli, but maybe at the time, with mask, they begin a new strategy, okay? If they understand that we mask the odor rapidly, maybe they will do something else. So they compare between early trials and late trials. What does it mean? They make like 1,000 trials, okay? They take the for a given mass onset delay, the 21st trials and the 20 late trials, and see if there is a difference. and I see here that there is no significant difference. What does it mean? They mean that even the mass don't promote a change in strategy. They still use, according to the hypothesis, the primacy coding of the glomeruli. Okay?
They
give
examples for different strategies?
No. I also tried to think about the strategy. I didn't get one that good strategy. Maybe not.
Well, you're basically assuming that you're erasing some information. So if the mouse is used to thinking of the three glomeruli as representing the cylinder, and then you ablate these three glomeruli, you'll find you probably learn with time to use another glomeruli. So whatever information is there, the brain will find a way to use it if you give it enough time. So their point is just that at least they're not in that regime. They're not that the mouse during their experiment has changed the way he thinks.
Go on, and the next step was to, instead of using now order A and order B, okay, which have nothing in common, they use a more complex mixture, because maybe this worked only for simple mixtures. Now they use, instead of 100%, they use mixtures of 60% of order A and 40% of order B, and the inverse, okay? And they see that we get, one more time, the same qualitative result, okay, with this shift. The shift toward the right, okay, is because now it's more complex to discriminate, so I need like more time to discriminate between A and B, because they're now just slightly different, not totally different orders. Okay, so now we just sum up the behavioral analysis before we get to something else. So we see that the performance, according to Moses' latency, was similar to the performance according to reaction time, okay, from a qualitative point of view. We see that the later mask onset, the better was the performance, which fits our hypothesis. We also see that there is no effect of learning between mask trials, and therefore mask trials do not promote any change of strategy. And the last slide we show that it's similar qualitative results also for complex mixtures. Okay? So now for now we're good with our hypothesis. And now,
I'll just add,
yeah,
from personal knowledge, no effect of learning this address. So what they do is, these are catch trials. Most of the trials there is no mask, but then every once in a while there is a mask. And the reason they do it is because if you just keep masking, the mask will get perfect with a mask. So there is less over information, they know that. So that was just showing really that doing these catch trials is good enough to avoid that.
Okay, so now we have our answer at the behavioral level. We want to understand what happens at the neural level. Okay, so we'll go back to our mitral cell. And the record of the activity of mitral cells, a lot of mitral cells, like 119. And we see two kinds of cells. Some cells, here in blue, this is recording for one cell, okay, have a firing rate. So we're active across all the concentrations for a given order. Okay? So now just forget the mask for a second. Doesn't matter what the order is, the cell responds. Okay? So we call those cells concentration stable. The other group is the unstable concentration cells. You see here that the cell responds only for the high concentration, but not for any low concentration. Okay? Here you can see some scaling according to the concentration. Here there is no scaling. Yes for high and no for any low concentration. Okay, just pay attention to the number of cells that we have. We have a lot, a high majority of unstable cells and a small group of concentration stable cells. Okay. So now what we see is here on the y-axis, we see the number, okay, y-axis here, the big y-axis is different concentration. Low concentration, high concentration. Okay, here it's the small y-axis, is the number of cells that were activated for this given concentration according to time. Okay? What we see for low concentration, the majority of the active cells were the concentration stable cells. Okay? That activate here quite sharply, fast. for low concentration, the majority of the active cells are the unstable cells. Then we see the switch for high and low concentration. Clear? Each line here is just one more cell that's activated, okay? One more cell that's activated. Okay. But now we are searching for our mitral cells that could encode this primacy coding, okay? We should find some cells that act really fast when I present some odor at a given concentration, okay? And what we see here, in blue, we have, once again, concentration stable cells, in red, unstable cells. Here, three concentrations, okay? Within a given concentration, the y-axis has no signification, it's just for the graph to be clearer. And here we see the response onset latency. Okay, and a line between two dots is like it's the same cell, okay, for different concentrations. We can see here that there is a group of concentration stable cells that are always activated the first, okay? Whatever the concentration is. We also see here that there is the activation of the cell, the latency for activation scales to the concentration, okay? The lower the concentration, the bigger the response latency. Okay, that really fits the kind of cell that we are looking for. A group of cells that already respond first to a given order for every concentration with the response latency scaling the concentration. So we claim that the kind of find the group of cells coding for the primacy. Okay?
Great.
So now, Jeff will present some computational model of this problem. We'll end by that.
Okay. So, professor, the researchers offered a computational model that may underlie the primacy code model from before, that we saw before. So we expect from this model to first be fit our behavioral window, and second to explain certain things. One of them is the fact that we saw in the behavioral results that in earlier mass onset latencies, the performance was above chance level, as we can see here, and then Mohamed explained. And to explain also the delay of the mask effect in the complex task with the mixtures. So you can see here that there's a shift to the right in the mask effect in comparison to the first simple task. So this model was based on the knowledge that we know about the connection between the peripheral cortical surface and the olfactory bulb. So it's based on first the feedforward connectivity between the mitral cells and the peripheral cortical cells, that we call the peripheral cortex from LPC, so you know. And this feedforward connection is the basis of coincidence detection of the mitral cells in the early SNP cycle. So we can see here that the mitral cells are integrated to one cell in the PC. The second thing is that there is random inhibition in the PC, and its purpose is to suppress the non-primary input that the PC gets. And we can see here in blue that this cell, for example, suppresses some of the cells that surround him. And the third thing is the memory property of the neurons of the PC, that the activated neurons remained activated to maintain the representation of the other until the initiation of the action.
Why the inhibition is random?
Actually,
it was observed in the peripheral cortex in reality.
Yes, that's what happened in, I don't know actually why, if you know why.
So we discussed there's some range excitation in peripheral, but then there's local and also other inhibition.
Right.
But whenever you activate something, it will generate widespread inhibition. So random just means that they're not introducing any specific structures that make notes.
So, other evoked activity was stimulated in the microcell by a random spatiotemporal pattern. And the activation of the mask was activated by synchronous activity independently of the other. So we can see here the other evoked activity here and here. And when the mask was before the other evoked activity, we can see that the activity in the species wasn't dependent on the other. But when it was after the other evoked activity, we can see that there is a pattern of activity that is dependent of the type of other.
Right?
You
need to explain this matrix. How do you see if it depends or not?
Ah, so you can see that the like these are it's like an activity pattern of in the PC neurons, and we can see that there is activation that relates to other B in red, and there is activation that relates to other A in green. And here we see that if the mask was early, as we saw in the behavioral results, the pattern of activation is not related to one of the others. It wasn't specific to one type of other. Okay. So I'm just reminding you that we said before that we want to explain the early onset why in the early mask latency onset latency there is a performance that is above chance level. So this is because the noise of the microcell. In some of the trials, the reaction of the response of the microcell was very fast, and that led to a mask failure and the incomplete suppression of the discrimination for the early mask. So I'll just explain more. We can see it here. Because the microcells responded very early, there was an identification of the other, and then although the mask came very early, it wasn't sufficient for the suppression of this discrimination because the other was already identified. But it didn't happen in the mixture experiment with the complex task, and that's because of the right shift that we saw also in the behavioral results. And that's because in mixtures, the difference in folds of the primary glomeruli emerge slightly later. So to identify the other, we need an activation of more glomeruli, so it comes a little bit later. So the identification comes later, and Sun also showed it. And that's why in early mask onset latencies, it wasn't above the chance 7.
The model was clear before we go to the discussion of the limitation. Just a discussion to recap what we saw here in this article. The kind of show that the only evoked activity can be used to make decisions about the order of identity across different translations using the system of primacy coding, okay? The first glomeruli called the order of identity. The other glomeruli called something else. Okay, this paper also emphasized the important role of individual glomeruli for order coding. Why? Because enough that one of the first glomeruli will not respond, I won't be able to code the identity of this other. This is very important. And Shiran now showed us a solution for a complex personal problem of progress concentration in variant order of identity. Okay, that's another way of saying what we say a lot of time. Different concentration, same order, and we also can identify. So now for limitations. In the experiment, they use only 3 mice. Okay, they begin with 5, but the 2 mice that did not finish the experiment, I don't remember why, so this is the method. They saw not explicit data of the reaction time as a function of the mass of the latency. Okay, I would have to see like some graphs it look like that. With here the reaction time, here the mass constant latency, and here there is really a correlation, okay? Like something like that. Okay? Before the 56 milliseconds, if the reaction time was smaller than 56 milliseconds, so there is no signification, but after that, some correlation between them, and they didn't show that, they just show the similarity between the two graphs, but overall, as far as it doesn't mean that there is a linearity, proportionality, and there's also no direct proof from my code. Okay, they just show high correlation, not causality. For now, if they will inhibit one of the three glomeruli, like high D or Q, using instead of Snell rhodopsin, using Haller rhodopsin or electrophysiology, we could really say that those three glomeruli code for the identity of the odor. And another limitation is the fact that in real life, okay, but the MEDES experiment is really good, but the conclusions I can draw from it are really limited, because real life is not like just smelling two odors and differentiate between them. I can also have to, they're really more complex, there are a lot of odors, and that's it.
No direct proof, when you say this is not causality, I would assume they will claim this is causality, right? Because they're not just recording neurons that seem to respond according to what they say. They manipulate these neurons and see that this affects the decision.
Yeah, but that manipulates directly those neurons. So that if I
actually want more specific manipulation.
Yeah. If I activate a lot of other neurons that they assume like block the other neurons,
if you knock out this whole D more clear that is the reason between the increased activity, so you might claim that you did something else that made those results.
So this is causality, you're just not buying the, you're saying the manipulation is not specific enough and not the one you would want to see be convinced.
Yeah.
But this is a causal experiment.
Yeah, the claim is causal, but we could, I can think about it. One could think about another.
I agree.
I have a
that they have 4 mice for behavior and 3 mice for the recompensation.
Okay. So maybe pull the behavior from the 7 or maybe not. So I'll just say a few more things. I think what worries me for all of our experiments, not just theirs, is that in some way, this is the kind of experiment you would want to do, maybe more specific, right? But you have a code in mind, and you just go and erase that code and see what happens to behavior. I think we may be thinking incorrectly about this. Maybe there is no one universal code that always works. But if you set up a test, they'll find a code that works for the test. So and erase it, you know, they'll find a different code. And it's not clear how much that teaches us about what code they use in Greek letters. They're trained a lot. It takes a couple of months to train them, and we never know if they're trained. It takes that long because they don't understand the rules of the test, or they need to learn to classify the 200 that don't think that's the right answer. So whatever it is, they do it for a long time. They can find the code that works. Right? Is that the code they would use outside to recognize stuff? Gotcha. And the last thing is that is that, you know, this code doesn't solve a lot of things that we know they do have to solve. So if you have background odors, and maybe, you know, you sniff and you get the background odor first, and then everything else is lost, right? In fish and pure form, and thick. So how would you recognize things that you care about that don't arrive first? But I think still it's a very interesting approach to, you know, go and try to look for a code.
Gracias.
want, and you're where you want to sit. On the one hand, here, so hold it.
I think I should consider all the advantages and different methods before you decide where to sit, because it's very critical.
It's critical because it's so hot there. It's so hot there, so I think it is critical. Here we can just turn off the air.
Yes, this is dark.
אז זה כן, השאלה שלנו לא כל אחד מהם, ולמה לא עשו...